Well, I guess it's still morning.
Yeah.
So good morning. Good morning. Thanks for very much for being here. On behalf of the co-founders of the Hub of Analytics Education, we want to thank you for taking your time out of your busy semester to be here and listen to some of the things that that we have. This is an initiative that was started by the accounting group through group coordinator at that time, Professor Tim Rupert, who's here. And it's supported by PricewaterhouseCoopers, Oracle NetSuite, Tableau Software, ACL Software, as well as Automation Services, which is the creator of IDEA Software. So we have some support through either free licenses that we've been able to acquire or actual direct funding to create some of the materials that you'll see here today. So, and we're always looking to expand that support, both here in the Boston area as well as nationally. And we continue to focus on that. So our goal here today is to answer some of the questions. You may have seen the Hub of Analytics Education, you may have heard somebody talking about it. Our goal here is to answer some very specific questions about the Hub of Analytics Education. And we'll do this, we'll go through this process of answering the questions, also give me an opportunity to introduce our co-founders for the Hub of Analytics Education. So the first question we're going to answer is, why does the Hub exist? What's in there? Why does it exist? So we'll talk a little bit about that. I'll personally have that conversation with you. The next question we want to have is, after you've learned about all the great stuff that's on there, we want to have the director of the Hub of Analytics Education, Alyssa Carr, and also a co-founder of the Hub of Analytics, Alyssa Carr, talk about how do you get access? Because I think once you see it, you say, okay, now what do I do to get it? Now that you've had it, the next question we want to ask, come on in, Elliot. Next question we want to answer is, how do I incorporate this? Or give me some ideas on how you've incorporated this into your classrooms. And Executive Professor Bill Goldman, also co-founder of the Hub of Analytics of Education, Bill Goldman, will talk about how he's used it in his class. I'll also provide a little bit of color commentary on how I've used it in my classes. But now after you've used it in the class, you're like, okay, well, I might need some help. How do I get help? And Anthony Grimaldi, who's a senior systems consultant, a senior systems analyst, also a co-founder of the Hub of Analytics Education, will talk about opportunities that are being provided by the D'Amore-McKim School of Business to be able to assist you in the implementation. We'll also talk about instructional design's role and also helping you be able to think about how to infuse this into your existing course structure. So those are the kinds of questions we want to answer for you today. And then, well, one last question is, what's next for the Hub? Because after you've heard about where we are right now, we at least want to tell you what some of our next steps are going to be and where we're planning on going with this, both here in Northeastern, nationally, as well as internationally. So we have some big ideas on what we want to do. So to start off is, you know, why does this exist in the first place? As I mentioned, we are funded by PricewaterhouseCoopers. And the CPA firms that we deal with are very, very interested in getting human resources that have an understanding about how to get client data, be able to manipulate that data, evaluate where the risks are in that data, and then try to communicate, whether it's auditing or tax or advisory, and then try to communicate that back to either the partners or to their advisory clients specifically. But what are some of the issues that they may be able to find in the data? So what are the questions they want to ask? Do they have the right BI, business intelligence tools, data visualization tools to run those questions, and then the effectiveness of communication? The problem is there's not a lot of universities and colleges that are creating those human resources to be able to fill those needs, specifically in the accounting market. And we can even extrapolate that even to a broader market, whether that's marketing or supply chain or any of our other disciplines, management information system. I mean, keep going. All of those disciplines, you know, there's not a lot happening there. So PricewaterhouseCoopers gave Professor Rupert one of their PwC Inquires grants. And part of that grant, they said, okay, well, Charlie, can you figure out what you want to do with big data analytics, right? So we carved a little bit of that off, and I gave it some serious thought about how to implement big data analytics in an auditing course, right? So I'm an audit guy, so we want to figure out how to implement this in an auditing course. Well, we could get the tool, because the tool providers like Tableau, ACL, IDEA, even Watson Analytics, they're happy to provide us the tools. Right? They're happy to provide us the tools. Yeah, we've got tools available, and we've got free licenses and some of these tools. Money. We've got some free licenses on some of these tools. But the problem that we found is there's no transactional level data that exists out there, at least when I was looking at this, so that you can take the tools and do some analysis with it. Right? So we lack any kind of data set. Now there's these little 1,000, 2,000 record data sets that exist out there, and you know what? You don't really need to understand how to use Tableau to figure that out. Our students would just open up Excel and figure out what's in there. But we had to force them into a tool that makes them a little uncomfortable, that they've never seen before, and that can handle millions and millions of data points. So we sought to create a company, and we have done that. And what we have created is Bibitor LLC, right? And it is, you know, it's an interesting data set that we've created, right? And it's based on an actual company. So it's not this fabrication. It's not just random data. So let me tell you about Bibitor LLC. It is a fiction, right? But it's kind of a crazy fiction. So these are some of the variables that are in Bibitor LLC. It is a 79 store locations that serve retail wines and spirits. Right? We thought, what would be a nice thing for college students to investigate? Wine and spirits. They all have some experience, some expertise in the product. Right? So it's a 79 retail location, wine and spirit, in the great state of Lincoln. Yes, we have created the 51st state. Yes, the 51st state. Lincoln, the state of Lincoln here in the United States. It has a lot of information, a ton of information. There are over 10,000 liquor and wine brands that are in the data set. Right? Over 10,000 liquor and wine brands. The inventory files, each inventory file has roughly 230,000 records in the inventory file. So you think about 10,000 brands by 79 locations, it gets big really quickly. The purchase file has 2.4 million records in it. And now it's starting to get big, I like this. The sales file has about 12.7 million records in it. So all told, we're looking at about 15 million records worth of data in there. And that's just the purchases and sales files. We're in the process of creating a payroll data set, other expenses, right? We are looking, we're trying to create what's the square footage in each store. So you have an understanding about what are the sales relative to the square footage in each store. In addition to just the data, we have supporting information. So think about how did this data come to be? Well, we have process manuals for sales and for purchases, right? Which describe how these transactions come about. We even have process flow charts that match up with it. So now we've got an understanding about how the data is created in the organization. We have the data. We even have financial statements that tie to the data. So think about this. We've got an entire company where you go from process level introduction all the way through the data to tie out the financial statements. Now, as an accountant, as an auditor, that's what our focus was, but we think there's some applicability across a wide variety of different disciplines. Right? In addition to this, we also have Dun & Bradstreet statistics, industry statistics, around the liquor business. So you can get some understanding about how does this company compare to the industry. We even have county-level demographic data for the state of Lincoln, so that you can take a look at, given the stores and where they're located, what's the population demographic? How many people are over 21? What's the income demographic in these particular counties? Right? So there's a lot of interesting stuff that you can think about doing with this, right? And trust me, we're not that smart to come up with all the great ideas. Right? And so that's one of the reasons why we're going out there and pushing all this out, because everything that you see here is an open educational resource. It's free to all faculty all over the world. for educational purposes only. It's open educational resource. Because we want to make sure that big data analytics gets out there and gets out there quickly. So this is Bibitor LLC. You know, the top sales are $441 million. Cost of goods sold, you'll be able to get in there and kind of mess around with it. All of the data right now is sitting in what we refer to as flat files. They're .csv or .txt files. And so, come on in. Don't stay there. Oh, you all said. They're flat files, right? So you can take these flat files and you can read them into your data visualization tool, your business intelligence tool. And we'll have, you know, Bill will get up here a little bit later and talk about, you know, functionally how you do that and what do you do with it afterwards. We're also working with NetSuite.com, which just recently was bought by Oracle, to position all of this data into a cloud ERP, an enterprise resource planning tool, so that you don't have to deal with flat files, big, huge flat files. You can actually get the data or look at the data directly in the ERP. Or, using an online database connectivity, bring the data directly from the ERP into your business intelligence tool. So that way, where we're trying to teach how all students can be monitoring management or looking at how management is doing on a day-to-day basis. So those are some of the goals that we've got for this, and we'll talk a little bit more about some of the things that we're going to be doing in the future. So there's lots of interesting data, lots of interesting stuff in there, and we want you to use it. So the data analysis tools that we are using are ACL and IDEA, and we have licenses, full licenses, not just academic licenses, where you can only bring in 2,500 records. We're talking every day, all 15 million records, you can use it in ACL or IDEA. ACL runs on a Windows-based platform, and we only have 55 licenses, and they're not concurrent licenses. Right? That's a little bit of a problem, but we can always go back to ACL and say, hey, we've got a lot of accounting faculty that want to use this, and we need more licenses. So we'll go back and negotiate with them. The other tool we have for accountants and auditors is IDEA. This is put out by Automation Services. IDEA, we have 60 licenses, and Anthony will talk a little bit about how those licenses run a little bit later on. But that stuff, also a Windows-based program, Anthony's come up with a great solution. He'll tell you about that a little bit later on. The other data analysis tool that we use, Tableau. This is for everyone. Tableau can be used in any discipline. It's not just accounting. The ACL and IDEA stuff is pretty much, it's created for auditors specifically to look at data and do audit testing for data. Tableau can be used for everyone. And then we're also working with IBM Watson and having conversations with IBM Watson on whether or not their tool our data can actually be run on their tool. And surprisingly, they're making adjustments to IBM Watson to be able to fix IBM Watson, to be able to handle the data and the cases that we're creating for their tool to work effectively. Bill will talk a little bit more about that. We have created exercises, right, for auditors. Now, obviously, I'm doing a lot of stuff in auditing. There's 9 different little exercises and cases that people can pull off the shelf, give to their students, and have them do some audit tests. We are also creating Tableau cases. Tableau funded us to create some cases. Bill and his team, as well as myself, have created, we've got one case out there, sales analysis, and we'll have another one here pretty soon looking at brand analysis, and we'll be looking at CVP, you know, cost, volume, profit analysis, and some other areas. So we'll eventually have 5 Tableau cases that are really focused on the introduction to management accounting and cost accounting. But they could be used for a variety of things. In fact, Greg Collier is planning on using the sales analysis case in a course that he's got coming up in the Masters in Innovation program this upcoming summer 2, I think that's what he said. And he's going to be not using Tableau, but he's planning on using Watson Analytics to take our case, but doing it using Watson Analytics. So these are the cases, these are the data tools we have, these are the exercises and cases that exist right now on the Hub of Analytics. So how do you get access to this? Well, I don't want to talk about that. I'm going to bring up our director, Alyssa Carr, who's been with us from the very beginning of all this craziness that we've been doing. So, Alyssa, would you come up and talk a little bit about how you get access? We'll see if this is now working. It is now working, so that'll make it go forward. All right? Thank you.
Morning. I'm just going to talk about different level of access between educators, students, and companies who want to use the site, and what you'll be able to see when you do have access to all materials. This is, when you go to register, this is a page that you would actually see. We have different levels. When you get down to membership, that's where it really counts. Students have certain access, educators have certain access, and companies have certain access. So, email. We instruct everyone to use the EDU, just so we have everyone who uses the program. We want to make sure that everybody's a current educator and faculty when they are using the data. It does take 1 to 2 business days of processing just to confirm they do work for those colleges that they say they're working for.
We've had some faculty who have signed up and they claim to be faculty when in fact they are not.
Yes.
And there are suggested solutions associated with these different exercises. So we don't want those just out there in the hands of students. Right, so we're trying to put some internal controls around it. So that's why educators have access to everything. Students only have access to certain things.
Yes, so when you do sign off, you will only have access to student materials and not everything. So do give 1 to 2 business days, and you will have access. So don't register and immediately email me. You will have access to all the materials. Next slide. So when you do have access as an educator, this is what you will see. And suggested solutions. Students will not be able to see any of this material at all. Also, we do provide instructions in Tableau if anyone wants to get access to the accounts for students and educators. There's also YouTube. We have a YouTube channel. And in case you want to know how to use Tableau in the classroom, implement it. Bill has created a video on how to implement this into your coursework if this is what you decide to use.
Do you have the website address?
It's
right on that business card.
Yes. And YouTube is also accessible from our site if ever you need to use it. And we'll go to our last site about updates. So we are continuously working on new material, as Charlie has said. So for instance, we have the payroll data to be uploaded soon. And then we have new instructor solutions that we will be updating to the website. Bill is also in the process of writing 3 new cases for managerial accountants. And as materials does get uploaded to the site, we do keep all our faculty informed of new materials that we ever upload, so you will get an email stating, this is what's new, this is what's coming, et cetera, et cetera. So anyone who uses the site, we actually ask that you share with us your cases and exercises. Because not only are you sharing with the hub, but you're sharing with all the other faculty that do subscribe to us. So right now, we have faculty from 37 countries, so not just in the U.S., 39 states within the U.S., and over 140 faculty, not just including Northeastern, that's throughout the U.S. We do ask if you're going to, we're likely to share with us.
Yeah, go ahead.
So you have over 37 people, or 37 countries are already sharing their materials. Are those not
No one started sharing with us.
Those are who access our material. Those are who have already started using it.
Okay.
Yeah, we're hoping that this becomes an opportunity for people to, if you come up with a case or an exercise, we would love to publish it on the Hub of Analytics Education.
Right.
So no matter where you are. Now, that's incumbent upon other people wanting to share with us, but we're making this available to everybody. We're hoping that others will. And as people do share that with us, we'll have it reviewed, and then we will publish it on the Hub and make it available to whatever solutions they've got, the cases, et cetera. We'll make that available to the entire community and also tell those authors on an annual basis how many downloads they had
of their particular cases, so that that way they can report back to their deans what kind of an impact they're having, both in their own university, but what kind of an impact they're having internationally.
Done.
Excellent. And so I thought at this time we'd probably get Bill Goldman to come on up and kind of show us or discuss some of the things that he did in some of the classes that he ran over the past, basically 5-6 months. Remember,
yeah,
while he's getting set up, we just launched the Hub of Analytics Education on September 15th, 2016, when we did a presentation out in Silicon Valley. So this is all very new. And so we're creating this stuff on the fly. And so there's lots of opportunities here to keep on creating. And we did some presentations in New York. Ryan and Tim were at that presentations in New York with PricewaterhouseCoopers and other presentations out in Silicon Valley to a group of faculty and professionals interested in how do you implement big data analytics, specifically with respect to academia.
Yeah, so I got involved in this project because Tim sat next to Charlie. So so I got involved in that way. And then when I realized what Charlie was doing was he was really giving information to students and to me that I could not replicate. I was teaching an upper-level accounting course, and I realized that a lot of the topics were the same as the intro course. Obviously, a deeper level, but what am I going to make this different? How am I going to make this different? I could give Harvard Business School cases. Those solutions are out there. And it's a very high level. And I got frustrated because some students had tremendous experience in their classrooms and their co-ops. Some students didn't have any. So all of a sudden, my brain was like this. And I'm saying, how do I have a situation where I can get those students that basic information that I want to get in the course, but also allow my top students to then go explore? And I said, okay, Charlie, come up with a transactional data set. Well, what are we supposed to focus on? Let's focus on some questions. Okay, what do we want our students to be thinking about? You know, these tools are great. Tableau's great, Watson's great, but you have to know how to form the question. And I started thinking, okay, well, what do I need in my course? Upper level undergraduate course, graduate courses, high level questions, details, and high level, kind of that balance. So I said, okay, what do we need? We need some BI tools. I don't want to teach SAS. Do you want to teach SAS in your course? No, it's miserable. I mean, I have a hard enough time teaching Excel. So I said, okay, I need a tool that's low bar, high ceiling, kind of mirroring my course. And that's where Tableau came around. I was fortunate. I saw a Tableau presentation, I've attended webinars, so I kind of got used to familiar with this tool, but it's actually really, really easy. So I said, great, we have this tool, but how do we use it? And then how are our students going to communicate that? So all of a sudden I started thinking, okay, let me get this tool in, let's incorporate Charlie's data set, and all of a sudden I now could design a course dedicated to this. Now, that's in the process. I only have 1 or 2 cases going right now. Three's coming hopefully by the end of the semester, but my goal is to be able to take an upper-level graduate course or undergraduate course, make an entire course dedicated to managerial accounting and data. That's the goal. And obviously, I would hope that you like the case and you can implement it in your course and also make amendments as needed. So quickly, let's talk a little bit about an example. So a sales analysis case. What types of things would you want to know about sales? Well, number one, what's total sales dollars? Our company has spirits and wines. Okay, great. We have how many records? 15 million records. How do we actually go ahead and use Excel? We can't. It's 1 million lines, tops. I don't want to teach SAS. We'll talk about that. Okay, so that's one thing I'm going to have a problem with. Next one, most popular bottle size. So now I can get into supply chain and say, okay, what do I have to order? Well, you know, we all have our favorite size, whether it be wine or spirits. Well, I want to investigate that, so now I have a store layout. Where do these things go in my store? Now, we don't have the full breakdown of the architectural plans for stores, but we do have size. So we can start investigating that piece. Okay. Popular vendor, negotiations with our vendors. Can we drop some vendors, maybe make our life a little bit easier? Can we use our leverage in future cases? And then last but not least, maybe we have some seasonality effects. Maybe I can have a stats examination where I have to create a dummy variable for seasonality. And that's kind of nice when you have transactional level data. So this sounds great, but let's just talk about how to actually do it. So give me 1 second, I'll just bring up Tableau. This is Tableau, for those of you who are not familiar with it. And it's really drag and drop. It's really, really easy. All right? So we have these things called pills on the side. And I'm going to go ahead and drop that in. That's one pill. And you know what? Let's just show you how easy this is. And let's say I want sales dollars by store. Go ahead and drop store in. All right. Done. I don't like how it looks. Let's just flip it. Okay. Sort. All of a sudden, I know what my most popular stores are based on sales dollars. 2 seconds. Students have fun with it. They enjoy it. Need a little analytics. All right. Baseline. Let's drop the average in there. Let's drop the median in there. And now we can say what's our average sales by store, median sales by store, and we're done. Almost no work. The nice thing about Excel, Tableau, is we can create these dashboards and storylines. So I just showed you my sales by store. So now what students can do, they can create those worksheets I just did in about 2 minutes. Now they can tell me a story. Bibitor, $441 million, 79 stores. Average sales, median sales, done. Sales by classification, spirits, approximately $282 million. Wine's the rest.
Spirits, approximately 64% of overall sales.
Yeah.
Is the data being processed as you make a single?
Great question.
Or have you set up all this so we can see it? How long does it take to set up?
Great question. So it's a combination. So for this particular presentation, it's all set up. I upload the data. It takes a few minutes, no question about it. And you can actually export Tableau workbooks to either save locally on your desktop, or it can actually be the whole package. And obviously the size data requirements we're going to talk about. But for this purpose, I base that right on it.
I would love to have a tool that was magic, but I don't believe that it's magic. There's got to be some stuff.
So the catch is the first time you upload the data, for this takes about 3 minutes. That's the catch.
Now, the data file, the sales data file, is 1.9 gigs.
Yeah.
Understood.
Yeah.
But that, you got to have a data set. Bill is creating neat little charts and graphs and so on. And the question is whether it is that easily manipulated or...
No, so once you export the data, it's locally on your machine. It's that easy.
So now, what he just did, that first thing he just did... That all the data is in there. That's how quickly he just created it.
Because I had saved the data on my desktop and I saved it within my computer, it's that quick. Once you upload it for the first time, it takes a few minutes
to load. Basic data file.
Yeah, but that's a few minutes. Yeah, no problem there. And then if you want to join data on a primary key, and assuming you join it properly, that'll be another few minutes. So what? And that's going to be some of the tech issues come into. But if you download it on your machine, it's quick. It's easy.
I think the question, though, you're doing these calculations on the fly, right? The data sets on your machine.
So, yes.
This isn't like a PowerPoint presentation.
That was my question.
You're doing these calculations.
Oh, yes. Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah, so that first worksheet I showed you, that's on the fly. That's just how quickly it processed it. Other questions? All right. So now, more entertaining for us, most importantly, but also for the students, now you present your story about this company. They're more engaged, they're not just listening to a lecture. It's more fun for everyone. Sales quantity by size. Spirits and wines, we can now sort that data. Turns out that 750 milliliters, most popular size for spirits and for wines. Let's sort that one so you can see. And it's done. Now you can all of a sudden do your supply chain planning. Sales quantity by vendor. All right, I don't like pronouncing that name, so I'm going to go Jim Beam. Jim Beam's the second most popular vendor behind Diageo. That's done. And now you can investigate what type, and I'm just an accountant, so you guys know a lot more than I do about your other fields, but now you can say, how does this apply to your field? Whether it be finance, marketing, supply chain, whatever it is. And last but not least, in case you're curious about seasonality, this is your trend line. People drink the most Christmas time and summer. And if you really want to drill down those details, we actually found 2 days that spiked. One was NASCAR, and what were concerts? All right, so another popular drinking days.
NASCAR,
all right,
what?
NASCAR and concerts. All right, so those are the popular times. But it's nice because we have the transactional level data, we can do that exploration, whereas before, you get compressed file, whatever it is, month sales, done. No transactions. So that's why this is nice. And we're also building demographic information, and we won't be able to officially do zip code information for geomapping. I know some people want to do that. However, there are some workarounds that we can talk about.
Is this structured off of real examples?
Yes, so we found a particular organization that every day they drop their ending inventory file on the internet. And every day we go out and scrape it and bring it in as a .csv file. So what we've done is we've created a program, a code, using R to take 2 days' worth of inventory, day one and day two, right? And we line everything up by inventory ID, which is the brand, the store, and the city name. And then we compare the on-hands. If the on-hand went up, we must have bought something. If it went down, we must have sold something. So we write the R code that does all of those calculations for all of these. I mean, you're talking about 365, 230,000 record data files. We wrote the R code to be able to do all that to create the flow. So this is, it's not perfect, right? It's an abstraction of reality, but still there's really interesting flow data, which includes what happens on each day of the week, right? What's going on each month, right? If they're closed, obviously you won't see much activity, right? But again, it's like I said, it's an abstraction from reality, but at least, and we've already collected now, we're through, obviously through today, we've collected all that data. So in addition, right now we're talking about the June 30 data set. There's also a September 30 data set that exists out there, and now there's a December 31 data set that we just finished this weekend.
So you're continuously?
We're continuously updating the data and creating, eventually when we get to June 30, 2017, we'll have 2 years' worth of data that's all sitting there ready for you to download as flat files, or once we get it into Tableau, have it, or into NetSuite, have it in the ERP.
So if you're, I'm just thinking, if you're trying to use some of the data in your classroom, is there an option to update it so all the analyses will change if the data changes?
Correct. So every time we put out a new data set, we also put out a suggested solution that is with that data set. So the case is going to be the same, right? Because we're going to describe the questions.
So you're going to offer it in separate.
We always will offer the case and the suggested solution. So right now, we've got volunteer students, they're undergraduate students and graduate students who, some of them already graduated, who will come back, they're authors on these cases with us, and they'll come back and they'll run through the basic code, because it's already hard-coded in these different elements and these different tools. And so they'll come in, they'll take the new data set, they'll run the code, they'll create the suggested solution, and then we'll publish that on the hub that's associated with the September 30 cases. I've got a bunch of kids coming in on Sunday. Again, the kids, they're all professionals now. They're going to come in on Sunday working on the payroll process flowchart, payroll process manual, and the December 31 audit questions. So we've got the June 30 sales analysis solution, and we've got the September 30 sales analysis solution for Tableau, and we'll be working on the December 31st sales analysis, this case that Bill just showed, you'll be working on the December 31 sales analysis solution as well.
Are you going to be looking for students kind of on a revolving basis long term? So if a student comes to me and says, I'd like to do more with this.
We would love, again, we're always looking for volunteers. Always looking for volunteers. Because, you know, this is an initiative, right? We've been able to get some extramural funding from Tableau and PwC. We're having some conversations with some individuals in Silicon Valley about maybe doing some additional donations, some additional underwriting. So we're getting a gift account that's associated with the Hub of Analytics so we can go out there and look for donations into this thing. We're making all this free. There's no revenue stream that comes off of this thing. So the extent that we, and again, we're all doing this just out, you know, this is not part of our job. You know, Tim didn't say, Charlie, now I want you to create the Hub of Analytics Education. We just did it because we think it's important. Yeah, we think it's important. Yes.
Yeah, so.
Say that one more time.
So I guess.
Well, again, it's so. What would you be looking for? One of the things we're always trying to figure out is what can we add to the data set. You know, I had somebody ask me, well, wouldn't it be great to be able to test internal controls? Well, we can program that in R. So if you have some ideas to add more variables into the data set, let's talk, right? We're just the accountants. You know, we don't know what you need. And if you need something, then guess what? I'll bet you there are thousands of other faculty in your discipline that also need it as well.
So there is
freight cost in there. We do have freight costs. We've got a freight rate associated with each invoice.
Yeah.
We've got purchase order dates. We've got invoice dates, receiving dates. We've got pay dates. So we do have some of that stuff, PO numbers, freight. So one of the things we don't have is we have some other expenses. We haven't created that data set with respect to the other miscellaneous expenses. And so we're just trying to figure out, we're not able to get that allocated specifically to each of the 79 stores. So that all those administrative costs, utility costs, we'll get payroll spread into the individual stores. But the other expenses, that's gonna be a harder thing to do for us. So all those expenses will be resident in the parent company store 00, which will just be a cost center. And so from there, you might be able to do some allocations based on square footage of each store, number of employees in each store, sales volume in each store, bottles, you know, whatever. All right. So I mean, that will exist as we keep, because we keep building.
And payroll data, payroll data will be store specific.
Yeah, Mark. Because we don't really care what truth and beauty looks like, so if you want to, because we don't care, right? Because it's not about what truth, because it has no meaning. The only meaning is the process of investigation, right? Because we don't care what the answer is. The answer is uninteresting, right? But it's the process you go through to ask the question, use the tool to answer the question, and how do you communicate it? Those are the three big things. That's even better, right? Well, again, but so for Bill and I, for Bill, Alyssa, for Bill, Alyssa, and Anthony and I to be able to come up with that, no clue. So we will work with any faculty member all over the world. So if there's a need, we're happy to do it. It's fun for us too. We're enjoying it. Yes.
Have you guys, from a marketing perspective, considered trying to build in customer level transactions so we can actually use CRM analysis and look at high quality customers?
So for this kind of stuff, that's difficult, this particular business. However, we're going to go up the supply chain. So right now this is a retail organization. So we have the program written that will go up the supply chain. And so this sales file, or purchase file, I should say, it is a sales file, will then be converted. And now we'll have 79 different customers. Those will be 79 different liquor stores. And the wholesaler will be buying from the importers, these same kinds of vendors, and then making sales to the individual stores, right? And so we don't have CRM at the retail level, because if you think about the construction of the data set, it's end of day data, and I don't have all that flow on a day to day basis. But with the wholesaler, we could potentially build in some interesting things with each of those stores.
As a part of that, have you guys considered adding in like sales incentives and sales teams and looking at actual...
We're not there yet.
Right, I know. So we're asking for data.
Yeah, well, again, so the it's
if we get the idea, then it's a matter of coming up with the logic to create the program that creates the variables that you need.
Right?
And that's the way we think about all of this stuff. So somebody said, we need an internal control variable. Okay, here's one. Any purchase greater than $250,000 has to be approved by the COO. We built, that's an easy variable to build, and now that variable's in the data set. So somebody has another data variable idea, fine. We'll figure out what the logic is to create the variable and populate every single line item in the data set. We're happy to do that. So, but it's just a matter of what are the ideas.
Yeah, right.
Again, we're not that smart, right? We have a limited business knowledge, and so to the extent that there's opportunities to expand this thing and make it really dynamic, now we have more users internationally that are coming to the D'Amore-McKim School of Business at Northeastern University and the Hub of Analytics Education. We become the center of all data analytics in the world. Maybe that's a little hyperbolic. Yes.
Two questions. This is your, thank you for doing this, and let me echo the "this is wonderful" theme that's been going and will continue to grow. I'm sure. Do you know enough? And you can't answer, just say you can't answer. But do you know enough about the firm to know when they have some sort of major change initiative? So, for example, if you see suddenly a jump in sales, might that be because they're doing something different?
We do. So when they have store openings or store closings, we know when that happens. Usually after the fact. When we look at it, go, what just happened there? Let's go into the news feed and figure out what just happened.
Right?
So if there's a NASCAR race, right? We can go, what's happened? Oh, that's what happened. Why is that spike there? It's usually an after the fact that we can usually discover these things when we see anomalies.
So if you see an anomaly, do you have enough sort of cachet with the company to be able to say, you know, what was going on? Oh, we had a big social media blitz, for example, and that's why you saw the jump, as opposed to something maybe sort of...
We don't have that level of data, so it would only be things that would be publicly available. You know, only those things in the public domain, not anything that they would do that wouldn't be communicated in the press.
Gotcha.
So everything that we have is all publicly available data, so we don't have any... they're not giving this to us.
Right.
They're not... They know that they're giving stuff to us, or they know that this stuff's out there,
right,
and they know that we're using it, and we've got permission through our Office of General Counsel.
Right.
They've given us explicit permission to do this, as long as we kind of anonymize the data, so that people aren't going, well, we've done our best to anonymize the data. I mean, I'm sure if you thought really hard about it, you could figure out what state this is.
Yeah.
But you know, we've done our best to anonymize.
In theory, probably reverse engineer some elements. So if we had more bandwidth,
right,
and there's Twitter or whatever it is,
yeah, exactly.
So
you know the company enough, you could actually see.
We could in theory reverse engineer, but that's going to require a lot more expertise, and I think
we have. Yes, exactly.
So my second question actually has to do with lessons learned. So one of the things you mentioned earlier, Charlie, was employers are looking to have talent to come in who actually understand these are the kinds of questions we have, and therefore these are the kinds of tools we need to use to answer those kinds of questions. So at some point, we're going to do some sort of lesson learned debrief to maybe come up with a rubric of sorts or some sort of heuristic to answer those questions. Is that soon? Is that during the summer?
Well, we're still in the data creation stage at this point in time. So we're going to gather some data from some classes. So Greg Collier's class, he's invited us in to gather some student data. Bill is going to be implementing it in one of his undergraduate classes this summer, and I'll be implementing it in my advanced auditing class this summer. And so our goal is to gather some data, evaluate the student learning, the opportunities, you know, what they think of it, and then be able to publish some work that would be working papers that would be available on the Hub, and ultimately be able to publish that in another journal. Yeah. I mean, we're thinking about a variety of things. But anecdotally, our students absolutely love this. And I'm hoping Bill will bring...
That's actually what I'm bringing up right now.
We'll bring this
so,
up right now. Anecdotally, our students adore this.
So anecdotally, I put this into an MSMBA class as a module, and they all said it was great. I mean, it wasn't the official class time, it was after that class that we just ran it, and they really enjoyed it. Also, some of my students, actually, I'll give you a couple quotes. The first one, this was more about using Excel than Tableau, but you know, we had a student here who never touched Excel, and now it's getting time to how quickly she can manipulate Excel without using the mouse. You know, her boss actually sits next to her and says, time, I don't want you to touch the mouse ever. And I don't teach them that level, but I try to get them used to Excel so I don't even know how to manipulate it. So she was telling me how great it was. And then on the Tableau side, this is one of the co-authors, actually. I'm going to say names here, but one of my co-authors actually got a job in part because of this work. He went out to the Northwest, no experience out there, no connections, applied randomly, three co-ops, like all our great students are, and he basically got a job in part because of this. And, you know, as an educator, what more can you ask for? You know, positive student relationships and them getting jobs and unsolicited positive feedback. So, this is really great for my end. Yeah.
So, Anthony, you're going to run a bunch of courses and how to learn and teach Tableau.
Well, Anthony will get up and tell. Well, why don't you talk about some of the challenges,
so,
Bill? And then
so,
we want to do this. We're going to talk about some of the challenges and some of the support.
So, in fairness, do not just open this up on day one and give it to your students, okay? Especially if there's multiple files. Because when you have the data joins, if you don't join them properly in the primary key, a 15 million record data set turns into a 45 billion record data set, and it becomes a mess. So make sure you have some experience with this before you do it, or else it's going to be a disaster, just like any technology. So there are some issues, and there are some issues on your student ends that you have to be careful of. So one, operating systems, load data times for the first time. Okay, so anytime you have to blend data, you have to make sure your primary key is clean. If your primary key is not clean, you're going to have a problem. Okay, and you can basically lock up your machine for hours and hours and hours on it. So make sure you tell your students, this is how I did it, and you test it out yourself. Yeah?
So on the operating system,
yeah.
Earlier, the Tableau can be run on either Windows or Mac.
Correct. Yeah, I think that's fine. I mean, I haven't tested out and watched the analytics yet. We've seen the video that Greg produced, but I think either one's going to work. Is going to work for you. I think when I said operating systems, I think it was more along the lines of your memory and your RAM. And I'm not a tech person, so I can't speak to all those details. But some students did have, you know, Chromebooks and things of that nature. It was tough for them to run given the size of the data set.
And if you're dealing with a senior level class, those computers are anywhere from 4 to 5 years old.
Yeah.
And they're on fumes, all right? And you ask them to start mashing some data, even through Tableau, this isn't working. Well, you know why? Because you've got an old, terrible computer, right? So when we talk about operating systems, it's also how old that thing is. That becomes somewhat of a problem.
Yeah, exactly. The other issue is the size of the workbooks. So these are too big to email typically. So you have to use flash drives or other Dropbox or something like that. So just be heads up on that. Some programs do run on servers. You can run Tableau server. Watson Analytics, I believe, runs on a server. So at that point, then sharing becomes much, much easier. You just restrict access or give access, and all of a sudden you can share all your work. But in this current configuration, we don't have access to that.
We don't have licenses for Tableau server or Watson Analytics server. But again, as we start moving forward and we have discussions with these organizations, given that we are mission-driven to make this available for free, we hope that they will understand that this incubator that we've got created here, it's worth their investment to provide that kind of support for the D'Amore-McKim School of Business. So we want Anthony to get up and talk a little bit about some of the technology potential issues and some of the support.
Yep.
So Anthony, you mind doing that, do you?
No.
I appreciate that.
It works. You can just go to that one. Hit that forward and you're good.
All right, so as you all know, I'm Anthony. right now we are hosting the website locally in the school business, and we're also hosting all the data and the exercises. So pretty much everything you need is going to be hosted in-house in the D'Amore-McKim School Business. We are always expanding our ability to provide support for software, as well as the licensing for this stuff. So for instance, the accounting group approached us and they were hoping to find a way to support the business analytic tool idea for their classes. And unfortunately, that's a Windows-based program. And as most of you probably know, most of your students probably have Macs at this point. At least half the kids have Macs. So what we were able to do was actually load IDEA onto a remote app server. It's a Microsoft product, and it allows anyone using any system that has access to the remote desktop software to run this software. So basically, we've actually created this a solution to allow IDEA to be run on both Mac and Windows-based computers for the students. And they can run that at home or they can run that here. That's currently using a 60-user concurrent license, which was provided to us for free. So if you have any other tools that you think that you might want to use, and it might be, you know, kind of operating system dependent, don't be afraid to approach us, and we can try to work with you and come up with a solution for serving this to the students in your class.
The other good thing about concurrent licenses
yeah.
is if we go and get, say, 60 to 100 concurrent licenses, well, that's going to serve a bigger population versus if you just got 60 licenses just for your class, right? Because it's 60 concurrent. Well, you may end up having three, I don't know what that ratio is, but say you have 300 students that are all potentially using those licenses, the probability that they're all using them simultaneously is very low. So if we can figure out how to get these things run on a server and run a remote app, that's a much more effective, I think. Wouldn't that be a more effective way?
Yeah, so concurrent licensing is really important for kind of hitting a larger range at a smaller cost. So, yeah, so as Charlie said, you could have 500 kids wanting to use this, as well as some faculty wanting to use this. And if only, you know, you see an influx of kids trying to cram for their class, you have 35 kids in the class, you know, you'll probably only ever see 35 to 40 people using this at a time. So that's great because we can support a wider audience on a much smaller budget. Now, I know everyone wants to know about support for the software and training. We are currently working within our group, Computer Operations, to provide that support and training, whether it be in your office locally to work with you directly or for something in your class. We're hoping to make this available, you know, basically from 7 a.m. till, I think, 7 p.m., which is our hours, to have support for you. So whether or not if you're teaching like a late class in the evening or an early class in the morning, somebody should be available. Now, right now, it's only in the planning stages, and we're only working with our, you know, with our teams currently to figure out who's going to be able to support this and whether or not what kind of training we'll be able to offer.
The other thing I'll also add, and I'm going to speak for the classroom design group, Jan Nichols' group, Mars, as well as Kelly. They are also going to be available as you are thinking about design elements and how you want to implement this into your classroom. We've had this conversation with them in the last few days, and they stand ready to assist you just from a design perspective. And then computer operations will be there to assist you just from an execution perspective, and maybe even just give you a little bit of help on how to run a Tableau inquiry, et cetera. I mean, their process is going to be looking to hire, because they hire students. So we hire students that are in data science over in the engineering school. Most of those kids have some exposure to these business intelligence tools. And so the goal is to hire the right people that are going to be supportive and be able to help you be successful in infusing this into your classroom.
So I don't know if you have any questions for me as far as support goes, but
excellent. Well, thanks. Let's just talk about that last question, which is, what are our next steps? Well, our next steps are to keep creating more data. Right? We're going to keep doing that. Add more variables. Add more data sets. And we're going to just keep doing this. As I said, we've got the code written, roughed out, to create the wholesale company. So we're going to have two companies. So our core product is the Vivitor LLC retail. Our next product is going to end up being the wholesale company. And then we're also going to create, for those individuals or those states or parts of the country that aren't really happy dealing with a sin product like alcohol, we're also going to create a retail toy store. So that way, it has the, you know, for those individuals, there are individuals, I've had people ask me, well, I don't really want to teach them about alcohol consumption. Is there something else? And so we thought, okay, well, let's do toys. And so we'll create a toy store, retail toy store, and those will be our three kind of core products by the time we get to the end of 2017. So we're trying to create more data, more data sets, et cetera. We want to publish more cases and exercises, right? There's only two of us, and we have a limited knowledge. So as you come up with ideas and you come up with those cases and those exercises, we want to publish them. We'll review them. We'll help you. We'll go through the process of editing. We'll publish them.
and we'll track the activity of these cases and exercises, right? We want to make sure that they're free and publicly available to everybody. And so we want to end up being that repository for all kinds of other types of educational materials that we can make available to all of our users. We also are looking to do research in this, mostly educational level research. So we're doing that kind of, you know, designing those kinds of programs or those kinds of research programs, and we'll make those things also publicly available so you can see what is the impact out there. We're also working with Valencia College. I was on a plane ride with the president of Valencia College, which is down in Central Florida. Predominantly a Hispanic population that they serve, adult population. So we're working with Valencia College to try to create a portable community college model that can be implemented across the country. The goal here is that there needs to be this kind of, you know, we're not talking about making them data scientists, but there's a need out there for this talent, this skill level for companies all over the world, all over the country specifically, to be able to use their data and get some meaning out of it. KPMG is building a large data analytics center, as well as the KPMG University, is a large international CPA firm, just up the street from Valencia College. So we're trying to have conversations with KPMG and Valencia College to have them create a big data curriculum that then KPMG can go and hire individuals coming out of Valencia to get jobs other than working in the Disney parks and making minimum wage. So we're trying very hard to work with other jurisdictional areas to expand the middle class. We've also just recently, on December 5th, we submitted a grant to the National Science Foundation to bring big data analytics education into the mathematics curriculum at Madison Park High School, right outside the back here. Again, the opportunity to have these young men and women be able to participate in the 21st century economy is important to me personally. And important to me, and important for this particular city. The business community is looking to try to figure out how more of our citizens can participate in the current economy. And so our goal is to try to figure out how we can infuse into the basic algebra curriculum or into the stats course, how you can infuse simple data analytics tools as an applied setting when you talk about something from a theoretical perspective. And we're hoping that this NSF grant becomes a portable model to all inner city schools, but even more importantly, even to some of the rural areas. So we're working with the folks down in Virginia to potentially bring this out into Appalachia and find some specific school districts that may be able to benefit from getting this kind of education, this kind of access to education. So we're trying to look at this as not just a higher education Northeastern thing. We're really focused, this team, this group of co-founders is really focused on trying to make a difference, and we really appreciate all the help that you can provide us as we keep moving forward. Elliot?
If I might, I think this is terrific. And I think the ability to get a data set and manipulate it is terrific. The question is, how does it translate into the application for our students going out into the work world, where the data set, you've got a huge data set built out of this, but gather is actually live data.
Yeah.
Is that kind of live data available for the wide range of industries that our students get involved in?
So I would venture to say, if they're going into financial services, you think about all the different transactions that are taking place. They're going into any kind of retail establishment. There's actually probably more data available versus what I've got, because all I have is summary sales data and summary purchases data on a day-to-day basis. In these retail establishments, I would think they have even more data. You know, because now we're dealing with zip code data, we're dealing with customer data. So, you know, what we're talking about is really just scratching the surface on what is possible. And so now this is an opportunity for faculty in some of these disciplines to say, no, this is a limited data set. When you get out there, wow! You would not believe what you'll be able to do now that you know these tools.
The student would understand how translate the classroom experience with Vivitor into a real life experience where they don't yet have the same kind of structure built.
That's a good question. Go ahead.
So, anecdotally, I only had a few students work on this with me who have kind of gone both ways.
So my students from Workforce who worked with me on this, they actually were given ideas from their perspective and then they brought into the case. We have our academic perspective and they're like, oh, I wish I applied that to the workforce. So it's a two-way street. And they've had that experience. They say, oh, Tableau, Power BI is Microsoft's product, and Watson. Those are probably the three main ones right now. I know that Bain Capital, Bain Consulting, I believe they use Tableau right now. And Tableau is really industry standard for most. Sometimes they use other tools, but it's all the same stuff in terms of their power. Does that kind of make sense?
The question is, what, you know, do we think...
Does it translate into...
Yes.
So from an auditor's perspective, it absolutely does.
Yes.
Our kids that have gone through the advanced auditing course that are now working out there, like, we use this every single day. And we're doing, you know, what you had us do, simple stuff. What we're doing out there, we feel very comfortable digging deeper, right? And so what this does is it gives them a great introduction. It doesn't go all the way down. But it gives them a great breadth introduction to ask the question, given the question, what tool do you want to use to answer the question, and then how do you want to effectively communicate that to whoever owns the decision rights. And so I think if those are the three things. I don't want these things to be we're teaching you how to use the tools, because we're tool agnostic. We don't care. We're not teaching one tool. We're not hanging our hat on just one tool. We don't care what the tool is. That's why in my audit class, you can use ACL or IDEA. I don't care. All right? If we can get to a point where we got Watson Analytics, you can use Tableau or you can use Watson Analytics. We don't care. All right? But once you get these kids looking at this stuff, and they feel, trust me, when you first tell them you're going to be dealing with 15 million records, there's a gasp in the room. And then once they get it loaded in there and they're doing like, oh, this isn't that hard. But it's getting that gasp and getting that out of the way quickly makes a difference.
I've gotten several emails from prospective students saying, I'd like to come to what you have in the way of data analytics and so forth. And until now, I haven't had an answer. So now I want to be able to say, you know, we're building this and it's translatable into
finance, management. Mark,
and,
you can talk
it,
about
it. It goes from the classroom into the workplace.
Right. Right. And I think once you have students coming back from co-op, you know, they're going to go, oh my gosh, we need this. And they're gonna be really excited about it. At least the students that I've had are very excited about it. Now, a lot of the reason why my students and Bill's students are so excited is because they're the only students in the world that have used this, right? I mean, literally, we finished the first data set on July 20th of 2016. I gave it to my students the next day. So, I mean, it was fresh from our scripting. Because we just finished the collecting the June 30, 2016 data, processed it in a week or so, did some little testing, and then gave it to them. And in the advanced auditing class, it was audit this company. That's the instruction, right? And they came up with all sorts of anomalies, which we then took, and then we adjusted the data to make it a little bit more, you know, to get rid of some of the anomalies. Because we found certain things, but for example, one of the brands, that vendor would drop ship to one store, and then that store would then distribute it to all the other stores. Well, that comes in as one big purchase into one store, and then the next day it comes out as all a bunch of sales to all the other stores, right? And I don't know, I couldn't determine it, so we just got rid of those brands, right? There's no need in muddying up the water by having transfers from one store to the other. So we try to identify those potential anomalies and eliminate that to clean it up a little bit. There's still a lot of mess in there. Right? It's messy. But we don't care what the answer is. Right? Yeah, Mark.
Just to support your point, I teach an undergraduate course in workforce analytics and grad school. And I can share the demand for students with those capabilities. They can go out and actually be talent related workforce analytics far exceeds anyone. And if you have kids that are very strong in quantitative skills or people who are working very strong in HR, but that sweet spot is in the middle of that functional expertise as well as a quantitative expertise. That's the opportunity, I think. And I guess it's probably the same in all the functional
areas. Yeah, I think you're right. I mean, it's just, you can hire a bunch of IT folks, but they don't understand the context. You hire a bunch of context people that don't understand the IT, you have a disconnect. And so we're hoping that this fills a niche. We're hoping this fills a need out there in the marketplace. And so, that's all we've got. I hope this is helpful. Bill and I, Alyssa and Anthony, stand ready to assist you in any way that we possibly can. Understand that our skills are limited, but we do our best, and we'll be happy to help you out, you know, tell you some of the little pitfalls that you may fall. And I know Anthony and his group are working to also create a support function. Just the same way that you have classroom support when you have a technology issue in one of the business classrooms, we're hoping to get that same set of people to also have the skills to be able to assist you in the in implementing this and infusing it into your courses. So thank you very much. We appreciate all of your time today. Thank you.